Morning, ladies and gentlemen. That doesn't sound like 1,000 plus people in the room here. Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. Now that sounds like we have the people in the room that should be in the room. On behalf of the Reliance family, my colleagues on stage, Sanjay, Jog, and Vaibhav, it is an absolute honor and a privilege to stand before you. I'm indeed humbled. Now, I don't get an opportunity to have a captive audience in front of me often enough. And when I do, I don't easily let go of. So the SHRM organizers, if I throw your schedule out of gear, please forgive me in advance. The ant and the butterfly, it's time to fly. We need to get to be the butterfly. Otherwise, whatever is staring us in the face is going to completely consume us and leave us dead, as Vineet mentioned. VUCA is passe, right? It is a disruptive world. But before we get to the disruptive world, let's just look at what our chairman recently talked about. Digital technology opened the doors to this life, the digital life. And indeed, that is where we are headed. Disruption really is the new eruption. The future is the new present. And you don't need to look around to see the disruption happening. Think about it. Brexit? Did anyone in the world think Brexit would happen? A reality now, okay? GST overnight made all the taxation pundits redundant. They had to actually get to start to completely reskill themselves. And that was not digital. But you start looking at digital, and the enormity suddenly starts to sink in completely. Take sports, take cricket. DRS has changed the way games are either won or lost. Earlier, an umpiring decision could cost you the match. Now, the DRS saves you the match. Look at life per se. Look at the way travel has changed. The Olas and the Ubers apart, look at the way that we've now talking about Tesla, we're talking about Virgin Hyperloop One, and it's all in the space of where the energy itself is going to change from fuels to renewable fuels. And that's what the world is headed to. The global world, to protect themselves, chased nuclear arsenal and went after it in a big way. Now, as technology comes into play, you don't need nuclear. All you need is a drone with the name on it for it to find anyone in the world and destroy it. That is where we are headed to. And as I was listening to Vineet, I couldn't help but recollect of an all-time favorite quote of mine. And this is from Robert Frost, who said, somewhere ages and ages hence, and now that has changed, to somewhere days and days in the future, I shall be saying this with a sigh. Two roads diverged into the woods, and I chose the one less traveled by. And if we do not choose the road less traveled by, if we do not become that butterfly, we will be fossilized. Alvin Toffler in the 70s had written one of my all-time favorite books, Future Shock. And during that time, he had mentioned The illiterate of the 21st century will not be someone who can read or write, but it would be someone who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. And I'm going to take some editorial rights from Mr. Alvin Toffler to modify that, to say the illiterate of tomorrow is going to be somebody who cannot format the brain and new learn. It's not about relearning anymore. And when we think about this, technology really is at the heart of it, whichever way you look at it. And when we think about this, the workplace is going to change dramatically. The workplace is going to be an anytime, anywhere workplace. The workforce is going to change dramatically. The workforce is going to be an anytime, anywhere workplace. We talk about the cloud. I'm going to talk about the human cloud. It's going to be workforce on demand. It is workforce that will be available at the click of a button. That is where we are headed to. And when we look at where we are headed to, the function that I strongly believe, and it's not because I'm part of that function, the function that I strongly believe would be the most impacted and will have a stellar role to play will be the HR function, but not in the avatar of an ant, but in that of a butterfly. We talk about big data, IoT, AI, ML, analytics, predictive analytics. This is going to be the language that we are all going to use. We are already getting familiar with. And this has come about on account of absolutely the phenomenal accelerating waves of technological disruption. What has this done? This has changed every element of our lives. It has whet our appetite for immortality, yet has every possibility of getting universal extinction staring us in the face. There are going to be tectonic shifts. Ladies and gentlemen, the tsunami has arrived. We can see it. It is staring us in the face. We either need to ride this wave or we'll get consumed by it. The HR paradigm, like it or not, has changed forever. And what that change is what Sanjay is going to talk about.
I don't like getting stuck to this, but I don't think I have a choice. a lot of technological changes, but no technology available to clear my throat. Yeah, but I think one has to just live with that. Yeah, disruption. Yeah, we've heard about a lot of disruption happening. Yeah, we see it in our business, or we did it to others from our business, whichever we want to look at it. Yeah, but the change is everywhere. Yeah, but I don't think the fundamentals have changed. Yeah, and I think Viniji alluded to that the fundamentals have remained the same, and therefore how to use technology to actually go back to fundamentals and even enhance them even better. So I think that's really what I'm going to talk about. So if my slides don't match what I'm saying, it's deliberate. So I was going to really talk about, you know, every element of what is written there, but I think the most important thing is what is there in the center, yeah, which is employees' experience. You know, what technologies have done is that it has given us more information about people. It has helped us in terms of understanding people a little more than what we used to. What technology has done is you know, also disrupted the way HR has worked. But if you look at the Indian economy, which is now moving from a consumer-centric economy to an experience economy, change was bound to happen. Yeah. It's nice and easy to say, but you know, it's something which is going to be dramatically different than what we have experienced hitherto. And therefore, pardon me for this. Once you start moving into an experience economy, yeah, the way we look at people, the kind of people, the way we structure our organizations are also going to dramatically change. And therefore, living in an experience economy is going to be an experience in itself. Yeah. And therefore, what are some of the things that are going to happen as far as the experience economy is concerned? Yeah. The one-shoe-fit-all models are not going to work, and therefore, mass customization or personalization is the direction that we are going to go into. Yeah. Some people say, look, this is not possible. How can you do mass customization? We run a large institution, etc. But if you look at India and Indians, we have been doing it over centuries and centuries and centuries. And let me give you an example. Yeah. All of us know, all of us have eaten the Indian bhel. I'm sure you have. Yes? Okay. The Indian bhel is about 20 different ingredients that are put together. Yeah. The consumer selects what is it that he wants or she wants, and the dish that comes out is a unique dish which is personalized to that person. We have been doing it for centuries. If you look at the Indian thali, it's no different. The chef, you know, in his all his honesty, prepares a thali for us, but the way it gets consumed is extremely personalized. Somebody starts with a sweet dish, it's allowed. Somebody starts with a soup, that's also allowed. Yeah. And therefore, nanoizing technology, nanoizing everything, and then allowing the person to put that experience together is where the world is going to go. And therefore, when we start looking at HR practices, services, processes, yeah, how can I nanoize it so that anybody can pick and choose and therefore create a unique experience for himself or herself? Yeah. So to me, that is about employee centricity. Yeah. I'm not going to bother about the other aspects. This is our moment about talking about Reliance. Yeah, I know we influence every single Indian in many ways. Yeah. Whether you wake up in the morning or you're going to go to sleep in the night, Reliance is always present. Yeah, in a very, very nice way. So whether it is, you know, safe plastic through which you consume water, whether you're eating your breakfast cereal, whether you're consuming entertainment, whether you're communicating, whether you're doing fashion or driving your car, yeah, Reliance is present everywhere. I wanted to give you an idea of what is the diversity of customers that we address. Because this diversity of customers is addressed by 650,000 of our employees. These diverse employees make sure that this experience that the customer has is a happy experience most of the time. Okay. So Reliance is not only about diversity of products, yeah, from petroleum to designing of clothes, yeah. Reliance is also about diversity of employees. So we have dress designers to designers of experience, we have journalists to geologists and all kinds of people, yeah. So the spectrum of people that we are looking at, as far as Reliance is concerned, is very, very wide. I'm contextualizing this to only give you an idea as, you know, when we talk about HR technology, and I did allude to you by saying that, you know, one shoe fit all models don't work, but one platform can work. And that's really what the idea of showing you the diversity is. Also, let me give you an idea of scale on which this platform works. Yeah, we operate as you know, one NHQ, four regions, 28 states, further divided to, you know, our presence in 6,000 different talukas of India. Yeah, as I said, 650,000 employees, the lowest unit being of two people, and the highest unit, of course, being of 22,000 people. Yeah, so that's the diversity and scale that we are looking at. And therefore, is it possible to have organization which was traditional in nature, which is our petroleum organization, and a very new organization which is retail, media, and geo, yeah, which is in the communication space, yeah, coexist together. Is it possible to have a culture which can allow us to coexist in the what was called as the what was it butterfly house and the ant house? Yeah, I think it exists within us. Yeah, it exists in Reliance, and therefore, what is it that we've done in terms of technology is something, of course, my colleague will do. But I've been given the task of doing a poll. So I'm going to straight go to that. Yes. So that's what we're going to do now. What I'm asking you to do, oh God. Yeah. What I'm asking you to do is, you know, answer this question, which is, what are the technology drivers for the future of HR? What you need to do is to go to this, what is it called, URL. Yeah, I was expecting an app. That's the world that I live in. Sorry, I didn't. Enter the event code, yeah, or go to the Slido app. Oh, God. Yeah, all of you know how to do this? Yeah, I know. Next time over, no worries. Yeah, they were saying that Jio needs to help. I said, yeah, next time over. Have you all got that? Okay. Yeah, one more minute. Yeah, quite expected, right? More seconds. Thank you. Matter. I'll go to good old technology. My paper. I forgot how to read actually. One is so used to. It actually came back, right? No, I think If you look at the kind of things that came up, yeah, from the poll, yeah, it was about artificial intelligence seemed to be dominant there. Yeah, I think machine learning was the other theme that was very, very dominant. Yeah, you know what I wanted to say to you was these are not just words. Yeah, these are things that actually happened today. These are things that are something that we live with today, and therefore get used to it. But it has given us a lot of opportunities in terms of how we relook at our people. Yeah, for example, our hiring, onboarding, training, and HR operations platform that we have has created huge amount of efficiency. Onboarding, which used to take 2 days, actually happens in 3 minutes. Yeah, and what high technology has done is sometimes it can lead to low touch. And that's something that I want all of us to think about. Yeah, how do I make sure that high tech is also high touch? And therefore, we are urging all our people. Yeah, and most of the people come up and say, "You are automating everything. What happens to us?" I think for the first time, we have an opportunity to do a real HR job, which is adding value to people's lives. Yeah, this time that we are getting, yeah, let's make sure that we utilize it for adding value to people's lives. So if I, from 2 days, I've reduced it to 3 minutes, I actually have 2 days available to do something with that time. Can I make sure that I connect with that employee? Can I make sure I connect with the family? I think first time there is an opportunity for us to use technology and make sure that we truly behave like HR folks. Yeah, over to Weber. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ashwini. Thank you, Sanjay. Good morning, everyone. So, yeah, that was the right slide that Sanjay was summarizing after the poll. And I think we had a very pertinent session from Johnny, from Vineet, Ashwini, Sanjay. And I think the example of the anthill, an ant becoming a butterfly, me, an HR person talking on technology, maybe I'm somewhere in the middle, neither I'm an ant nor yet a butterfly. But I think the point and message there was that we HR folks need to understand the technology and understand that how technology can actually enable the whole of the HR paradigm and the shift that is expected from HR. So while Ashwini and Sanjay talked about how things have to change within the HR and how we are focusing on the HR, we also need to appreciate that the whole ask from the HR is changing, and that is dramatically changing. So taking again the example of the anthill, on the left side, when you see in the past, usually the HR was seen as an enabler to the business. But the focus is now shifting that how HR is going to help each employee to grow the business by day, by week. And that's a huge change in the shift, and that's a huge help that each and every CEO is asking from the HR today. Similarly, the value was seen in terms of the cost, quality, and human capability. But combining this human capability in terms of the technology capability, when we talk of agility, what we mean is cloud. When we talk of connectedness, we are talking about 100% digital. And we are looking at creating those solutions which are future ready. So the ask today from HR is actually to lead the path that if you want to move from anthill to trees and the butterfly house, then can you actually provide us a whole system and the architecture which can help each and every ant to start moving, not just in the lanes to follow. Like Johnny mentioned, that earlier it was expected to legislate the process and expect the behaviors to change. That's really the mindset of an anthill. But now HR is expected simultaneous to manage the anthill as well as create new paths where each ant can actually follow their own path. The levers of the business have fundamentally changing from globalization and industrialization, which was the basically the underlying dimension. There was economies of scale, one solution fit all. So you were globalizing and standardizing the whole industrialized setup. What also Vineet talked about is the collective capability of many people doing things in one way. But that has significantly has to change today in terms of how you are intelligently automating processes, systems, in context to various high performing teams. Sanjay talked about it. If you look at the Reliance landscape today, it is simultaneously performing quite well in the manufacturing and the economies of scale kind of business in the hydrocarbon era. At the same time, it is actually also going about into the retail business, focusing on the consumers, as well as with the geo launch into the telecom and the new technology business. The ask of all of these teams is fundamentally different. And no longer you can have one solution, one kind of technology, one kind of ERP systems which is servicing both the anthill as well as the butterfly house. All of this has to be executed in a new mindset. And that mindset has to shift from stage gate mindset, what we call as SDLC, standard software development lifecycle. Some of our techie folks understand these terms better, the waterfall mindset, to liquid delivery. You are always on the go. It's a DevOps mindset, agile mindset. It's continuous integration, continuous deployment. Now that's really the fundamental shift in the ask from the ecosystem of business, the ecosystem of outside the organization, and the onus is coming onto the HR fraternity. And of course, the HR fraternity has to conceptualize, define, and design a new kind of an HR platform. And Sanjay rightly mentioned, it is one HR platform, and if it has to service and support multiple type of teams in different contexts, diversified workforce, geographically dispersed workforce, then this platform has to be in kind of an ecosystem platform. But before I delve deeper into what we mean by that, a future-ready HR ecosystem platform, we also need to understand that most of the organizations where they are today and what kind of a journey are they looking forward to. So most of the organizations have a traditional ERP at the background. To visualize this, if you look at an anthill, it has like a defined paths. It has, similarly, organizations have very defined processes. They're well laid out ways that things will only happen like this. And the systems were defined like, if you deviate from that kind of a process or a step, the system would actually kind of not allow you to do that. And then those flexibilities do not exist most of the systems, and these systems is what we call a system of records. These global systems got developed over the last 20 years, got adopted by the most organizations, large-scale organizations globally. It takes many years journey to adopt them, and suddenly most organizations finding that these organizations are not letting them move forward in a fast and agile manner, which is the ask of the environment. From system of record, you really need to move to the systems of engagement and systems of insight. But this is a long journey. This is not something that can happen like this. And many vendors, many solution partners are around, and they also understand this. But there is a path you have to go through. The path is actually going to be a more of a balancing act. And when your system of records and system of engagement needs to be supported by a middle layer, what is typically called microservices, service-oriented architecture, API layer. And this is a step-by-step journey. The endeavor is basically you have to look at these each systems, break them into components, hiring, performance, rewards, operations, engagement, and see that how you can actually modularize them and move them slowly towards the journey of systems of engagement. This brings you to a path of acceleration. In this path of acceleration, when you look at your various IT systems portfolio, you have to evaluate what you need to retain, what you need to discard, and bring new SaaS solutions, make them more future ready. This will give you the velocity and the acceleration that is required for the business. However, the velocity itself will not give you the performance, which is an outlier for business. To outperform, you have to define your processes into services. And each of these services, of course, have to be mobile first. Johnny mentioned everybody, all the things are coming to the mobile, to the individual. Your platforms need to integrate the Internet of Things technology. The data will come from various, various sensors that are ubiquitous now. And the AI and cognitive technologies need to work on this data to keep enabling these services in a fast and agile manner on the go. Only when you have actually covered this journey, we can expect that we are innovating on our core applications and getting the right value. Your speed to market is going to be ensured by this liquid delivery. Innovation has to be in the form of industry assets. They will, industry assets are going to change fundamentally. Intelligent automation is going to give you the exponential productivity that is expected. Sanjay mentioned about doing onboarding earlier in days and weeks, and now onboarding actually happens in seconds and minutes. And that's an exponential kind of a productivity gains which are possible. There are back-end processes which will have to be standardized, institutionalized, and they will be continued to be adopted at an industrial scale. And you can expect most of these technologies, it's very important to understand this. So the solutions that you develop are no longer going to be geographically limited. Any solution that you develop in India has the potential to be scaled globally, and any solution developed somewhere else in Silicon Valley has the potential to be scaled in India. And in that context, your cost arbitrage in a global scale is significantly going to be changed if you adopt the technology dimension. I'll delve deeper. This is a slightly heavy slide, but the intention is not to really understand each word written on it. The message here is that the devil lies in details. It is a lot of speed work to be done. It's a hard work in terms of moving from the anthill to the butterfly house. Our traditional ERPs are mainly, you know, they are like independent systems, most of us know. But when you look at from a customer perspective, employee perspective, you see that to do an end-to-end stuff, they are actually going into different systems, doing part of the processes, and we are usually expecting the consumers to integrate this stuff. Now that's a thing of the past. But to move to the future, most of the organizations will have to have these important components in the platform, which includes a hybrid computing platform at the base as an infrastructure, a data lake on top of it, which will actually pull in data from multiple systems and bring it together in one common data lake. And on top of it, you will be having very composite apps, which will be focused on specific user segments, on common processes, and finally, this whole platform has to be seen as an ecosystem. These platforms are no longer going to be just for the employees. This is another important. So if you look at the innovation access that Vineet significantly talked about, the most important innovation access to my mind for HR fraternity is that you will have to start thinking beyond the organization. And Sanjay and Ashwini knows that when we launched recently our learning platform in Jio, the learning platform is not just for the employees, it is also for the partners. And there's almost 500,000 population of the partners who is leveraging the RIL Enterprise Learning Platform to do their job well, to become from an ant to a butterfly, and support their customers, which in help is helping the business to grow. And that's what we call as a platform ecosystem. So imagine a platform that when you're doing hiring, it is not just helping the recruiter and the manager. The hiring platform has to help the candidate. Your performance platform has to not just help the teams internally. Your performance platform has to help employees to be able to develop a better career. And when you look at the future of work, the future of work is also I'm sure there are many sessions about it, people will talk about it. The organization of the future and the future of work is not about just the people within your organization. So if your platforms are not able to scale even beyond your organization to different kind of population segments, today they might be employees, tomorrow they are partners, third day they are your candidates, fourth day your alumni, fourth day your business partners. The same platform needs to fundamentally re-architect itself to be able to service all of these customers. Having said that, it does not fundamentally change the ask that if you have to learn, you need to have the right fundamentals of learning. If you be able to deliver efficiently on your work, the right levers of performance management has to be in place. If you want the right human assets to be available in time, then your hiring process and your assessment process have to be just in time and really, really sharp. But this ecosystem, if you see on the top of the slide, we are saying your even consumers are going to get connected. There are examples of the platforms where people are exchanging information outside the organization domain, and that is going to impact your organizational processes. We are talking of business partners. We are also looking at business process networks, another important axis of innovation. No longer HR platform has to look within the HR platform. The HR platform has to integrate very well and support the other business platforms. And of course, the Internet of Things. Internet of Things is just getting started. Already various organizations are trying small wearable devices which are giving health and employee data. And when data comes into the organization, what do you do with it? How are you going to help the employee back? How are you going to connect with your medical services, medical benefits partners to be able to give very specific help to your own employees at point of need? Now, this ecosystem, I'm sure that many organizations are attempting to look at the wider landscape, that your entire user base of your HR platform is no longer just the employees and the managers, but a significant population even outside your organization. And that brings in the important dimension when we actually mention systems of engagement and system of insight. Engagement is about experience. And insight, the entire data and analytics piece needs to support both the operations behind the platform as well as the analytics, the experience of the user who's in front of the platform. So the fundamental paradigm shift is not just the HR fraternity is being tasked to help the employees to do their job fundamentally better, but the HR is also being asked that the entire ecosystem of our employees, business partners, vendor partners, candidates, future employees, ex-employees, how this entire community is going to be supported by the HR platform. And with that, may I request Ms. Ashwini to sum it up for us?
So I'm back again, like the proverbial penny, okay, much as you like it or not, like I said. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Can we hear a good afternoon, a loud good afternoon? Good afternoon. Okay, I promise I won't take long, but let me just quickly sum this up. I think where we are headed and where we are headed is pretty much on the screen, and this is actual reality of what we're going to see here. As we think about it, let me end with this last slide. We've talked about heading into a digital world. We've talked about getting into a digital world. I think somewhere along the line we must not lose sight of the fact that it is still going to be about connecting with the heart. While we move from hierarchy to teams, hierarchies are dead now, boxes, lines will go away. As we move from retention, it is the employee value proposition is going to be about employee experiences. It's going to move to employee experience proposition. Careers are not going to be what people will look at. What they will look at, it's going to be a precariat workforce, right? Workforce on demand, available anytime, anywhere. From frameworks, guidelines, you're going to move to flexibility. It's not just going to be about HR business partnering, right? We need to get into HR ownership, and I think that's where it will get to. So you think about it, the challenge for us as HR professionals is imagine a mood meter at the entry gate. Does 100% of the employees come in with a smiley? During the course of the day, is that smile still there? When they leave the workplace, is the smile still there? Do they wake up on Monday morning saying, thank God it's Monday? And it is on that note, I'll just share a small story in terms of what perhaps we need to do. This is a story about a father with a young daughter crossing a bridge. There was a flowing river under the bridge, which was a very dangerous river. The father, out of concern, told this young daughter of his, "Hold my hand." And the daughter turned around and said, "No, you hold my hand." The father was perplexed for a moment and said, "What is the difference between my holding your hand or you holding my hand?" She said, "You know what? If I hold your hand, there's a possibility if we fall, you might let go of my hand. But if you hold my hand, there is no possibility of you ever letting go. So in this day and age of digital revolution, of digital tsunami, of digital disruption, let us not just bind, but bond. Let us reach out to each and every employee to ensure we reach out to hold their hand, we reach out to connect with the heart. That will make us the butterfly that we should be." Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.